created by nurses for nurses. Are you ready to take your learning to the next level? Sit back and crank up the volume. Here's your host, John Haas.
Okay, everybody, welcome to another episode of NRSNG.com. My name is John. I'm an intensive care nurse at a level 1 trauma center in Dallas, Texas. Today, I wanted to talk about hydrostatic versus oncotic pressure. This can be a little bit confusing for people. I remember in nursing school having a hard time understanding it, and kind of getting a grasp of it has really helped understand the pressures and things a bit more. So before I start, I want to let you know that if you go to www.oncoticpressure.com, you'll be able to download this entire presentation in PDF form, so you can have it for notes and to make your notes on and remember everything that you've learned. So that's www.oncoticpressure.com. You can also find it at nrsng.com/freebies. So either one of those, you'll be able to get this presentation and make your notes. Okay. So when we start trying to understand the difference between hydrostatic and oncotic pressure, first of all, we have to understand what osmosis is. Now, we probably learned about osmosis in our Bio 101 class and in Intro to Chemistry, but basically what osmosis is it's really the passage of liquid through a semipermeable membrane from an area of low concentration to an area of high concentration of solute. So basically what we have is we have our liquid here, and inside our liquid we have a bunch of solutes. Okay, here's all of our solutes. And between that we have a semipermeable membrane, which means that fluid can pass, but things of a specific size are not able to pass. So liquid can pass through, but these little solutes can't pass through that membrane. So what the liquid's going to do is it's going to pass through this membrane until homeostasis is reached, until the concentration of the solute is equal on either side of that membrane. So that's what osmosis is. And that's an important concept to understand. So basically it's the passage of liquid from an area of low concentration of solute to an area of high concentration of solute to achieve equilibrium equal concentration of that solute on either side of that semipermeable membrane. Okay, so what is oncotic pressure? Now this definition comes from Wikipedia, but it says that oncotic pressure or colloid osmotic pressure is a form of osmotic pressure exerted by proteins, notably albumin, in a blood vessel's plasma that usually tends to pull water into the circulatory system. Okay, so what does that mean? So first of all, what is a colloid? Okay, if we go back to that previous slide there, we saw that a colloid, what a colloid is essentially, it's a substance that does not diffuse easily across a semipermeable membrane. So as we saw there in that previous slide, so all these little solutes in here, those are going to be referred to as colloids. So they're not going to perfuse across this membrane, and so that's what we're talking about when we're talking about our colloids. Okay. So then what again is oncotic pressure? Basically it's the pressure that those colloids, the proteins like albumin within the blood, exert to draw water into the capillary system. Okay, so we have our capillary system. And what oncotic pressure is, and within our capillary system we have proteins like albumin. Okay, and albumin is a large protein, and it's not going to be able to get out of the capillary system under normal circumstances. So what's going to happen is we have all this albumin in here, and we have all this fluid outside the capillary system, and what that albumin is going to do is it's going to exert a pressure or a force to draw fluid into the capillary system. So that's why it's called colloid osmotic pressure. It's the osmotic pressure that these colloids are exerting within the capillaries to draw fluid inside the capillary system. So albumin is going to be the one that we really focus on within the body, because it's going to be one of the it's going to be the one that exerts the most pressure. It's a very large protein within the capillary system. Okay. So what is hydrostatic pressure then? This definition comes from CV Physiology. It's a great site to go check out. But what hydrostatic pressure is, it's the pressure that drives fluid out of the capillary system. And it's highest on the arterial end of the capillary and lowest at the venular end. So here again we have our capillary. Remember, we have all these colloids, all this albumin that's drawing water in to the system. And what our hydrostatic pressure is, it's that pressure. So over here we have our heart, and as blood leaves the aorta, it's leaving that under pressure. And this capillary system, or the arterial system, is under pressure as well. You know, that's under our pressure to push that blood throughout the system. So it's a highly pressurized system. And as it gets to the capillaries, it remains under pressure. And so what's going to happen in these capillaries are very permeable. So let's show that this is a very permeable wall that the capillaries have. And what happens is, as the blood reaches the arterial end of the capillary, what's going to happen is that force that blood is under, that pressure that blood is under, is going to push fluid out of the system of the capillary. And that's what they're referring to here. That's called filtration. So that's going to filter the blood, it's going to push some of the fluid out of the capillary system, and then as the blood passes along the capillary system, it's going to reach the venular end. So this is, then we're going to go back to the veins and back to the heart. Okay, so as we reach this side, we have all this albumin that's still here, and that's going to draw some of the fluid back in. So it's going to get rid of what we don't want, bring in what we do want, and keep that homeostasis with our blood. So what's going to, here, let's go to the next slide here. So like I said, what creates, so over here we have our heart. What's creating this hydrostatic pressure? Okay, so our aorta is leaving our heart, and it's passing along in here to the arterial end of our capillary bed. So here's our capillary bed. And the blood leaving the heart is highly pressurized, right? And that squeeze from the arteries is going to keep that blood pressurized. So as it comes into the capillary system here, this capillary is semi-permeable, and that pressure within that artery is going to actually push some of that fluid out, okay? And that's going to, when we're talking about capillary hydrostatic pressure, that fluid is going to go out into like the third space and things like that. So that's kind of what we're talking about there. And as that blood passes through, so that blood's been filtered out there, as it passes through here, we have all this albumin within the capillary, and that's going to draw some of that fluid back in. And then the blood's going to go back to the vein, and it's going to come back in through the superior vena cava, back into the heart, of course. Okay, back into that high pressurized system, and just repeat that process over and over. Okay. So how do hydrostatic and oncotic pressure actually work within the body? Okay. So if our, this is just incredibly overly simplified, but here we go. So if our capillary hydrostatic pressure is greater than our oncotic pressure, we're going to have excess fluid leaving the capillary system. And where our capillary hydrostatic pressure is less than our oncotic pressure, we're going to have fluid enter the capillary system. Okay? So let's talk about the capillaries really quick. Capillaries are very thin walled vessels. They're actually only about one cell thick, and they're highly permeable, as you can see. They're very permeable to that fluid, and so that's going to allow for that osmotic pressure and that hydrostatic pressure to actually work. Okay, so that's why this is possible. It's possible due to how thin these capillaries are, and the pressure going into them, and the pressure inside of them as they pass from the artery to the vein. Okay, right, we have our artery that branches off into our capillary system, and that comes back together to our veins. So heart, artery, capillary, vein, back to the heart. Okay, so that's where the capillaries come into play. Very thin. This is what helps to feed the tissues. This is, and we'll go, let's see, here we go. So yeah, here's our heart. It's going to leave the heart here, and it's going to pass out into the upper body. Here's capillary system to kind of feed the upper body. We're going to feed the liver. We're going to feed the kidneys. We're going to feed the lower body. So that's how in a lot of ways, that's how the body is getting its oxygen. That's how it's getting its nutrients, is through the capillary system feeding these tissues. Okay. So here we go. This is where we're going to actually show kind of what we've been drawing this whole time. So here is, let's put our heart over here. Here's our heart. So here's the arterial end of the capillary. So this is a capillary. And here's the venal end of the capillary. So this is going back to the heart. This is deoxygenated blood heading back to the heart. Oxygenated blood leaving the heart, going into the capillary system here. So as blood enters the capillary system, our colloid osmotic pressure throughout the system is going to remain steady at about 25 millimeters of mercury. So that's really kind of the that's the pressure that albumin, for example, those colloids inside the capillary are going to exert to draw fluid into it. So that's a pretty constant as it passes through here. It's going to be about 25. But what's going to change here is that our hydrostatic pressure is going to, as the blood enters the heart here, it starts at about 35 millimeters of mercury. And so because that hydrostatic pressure is greater than our osmotic pressure here, what's going to happen is it's going to force some of that fluid out, and we're going to get that filtration there. And then as it passes towards the venal end, what's going to happen is our hydrostatic pressure actually decreases as it goes down. And so our hydrostatic pressure here is actually going to be less than our oncotic pressure, and so that's going to allow fluid to come back in, the resorption of that fluid. So that's really what happens. And again, what's really exerting a lot of this force is going to be these albumin molecules here that are very large. So it's coming in at a high pressure, and that's forcing fluid out. It's passing along the capillary system, and that hydrostatic pressure is decreasing. And as we lose some of that fluid, we're forcing some of that fluid back into the system. Okay. So that's really kind of how that works. If you want to get a copy of this PowerPoint, you can go to oncoticpressure.com, and you can get a free copy of this PowerPoint presentation, or you can go to NRSNG/freebies to get it as well. Okay, so let's just draw the system again real quick. So we have our heart, aorta. So what happens is this is all arteries. The aorta branches into this capillary bed, the arteries branch into this capillary bed that then comes out into our vein, and that eventually comes back to the superior vena cava, back into the heart. Okay, so as we're leaving the heart here, we have hydrostatic pressure. Okay, that hydrostatic pressure coming into the heart is about 35 millimeters of mercury, passes through, and our hydrostatic pressure decreases. So what we have here on the venal end is going to be our oncotic pressure. Okay, so with our hydrostatic pressure, that's pushing fluid out, and with our oncotic pressure, we're drawing fluid in. So when we think hydrostatic, think heart. When you think oncotic, think albumin. So hydrostatic, heart, out, pushing fluid out. Oncotic pressure, albumin, think in. Okay, so that's really kind of how those two play in. So, as we have with a situation like heart failure, what's happening is we're getting that buildup of fluid inside the system. Okay, so we're getting that fluid, that heart is not pumping as well, and it's not pushing fluid through. So we're getting a buildup of that hydrostatic pressure. So. And so what that's going to do is that increase, so with CHF, I'm sorry, with CHF, what's going to happen is we're going to get that weak heart, and it's not going to be circulating the fluid as well, and so we're going to get a buildup of that hydrostatic pressure. And what that's going to lead to is that's going to lead to edema. And on the other end, in a situation like malnutrition, we're going to have decreased albumin. And that decrease in albumin is going to lead to a decrease in our oncotic pressure. So what that's going to do, if we have a decrease in our oncotic pressure here, we're going to draw less fluid in. So that's going to lead to like the third spacing and the edema as well. Okay, so I hope that makes sense. Again, if you go to oncotic pressure, .com, you can get the PowerPoint. You can also visit us at NRSNG.com, or you can email me at contact@NRSNG.com. My name is John. I appreciate you listening. If you have any questions, please be sure to contact us.
Visit us at NRSNG.com for disclaimer information and to keep the learning going.